So, just had a question that came in about how to choose the correct HPLC buffer. Now, this is a big question. There's a lot that goes to this. So let me try and give you a sort of a big picture answer first, and I'll give you some details. To get the real details, you're gonna really have to sit through a talk on, I give a special talk that's an hour long, specifically on pH in HPLC. But let me sort of give you a big picture concept. So first concept is pH important? If your analyte is an acid or a base, pH is incredibly important. You must set the pH properly. If your analyte is neutral, if it's benzene, toluene, xylene, then pH has no effect at all. Doesn't matter what pH you set, don't worry about it. So first you have to determine, are you working with acids and bases or working with neutrals? Neutrals, don't worry about it. Acids and bases, start worrying. So the next thing is choosing the right pH. Now there's an entire discussion that goes into this. There's historically a big philosophy as to, you know, choosing the right pH based on the pKa or the pKb of your analytes. That gets really complicated. So let me give you my simple solution that works for 90% of the people. I won't claim 100%, but 90% of the people. You got to bear with me here. But if you're running organic acids, if your analytes are acids, then you want to put acid in the mobile phase. Acid for acids is the way I remember it. So what you're doing here is if you have an acid, let's say benzoic acid, it could exist in two forms: neutral benzoic acid, ionized benzoate, right? Sodium benzoate is the ionized version of benzoic acid. The ionized version is very water soluble, comes off early. The non-ionized version is comes off later. So these two compounds, the same compound but the two forms, have different retention times. You don't want to live with that. That's terrible. So you must set the pH in order to keep it from ionizing. So low pH will make it 100% neutral. Once it's 100% neutral, life is easy. So you want to set, so here's the official rule, 2 units below the pKa. So set the pH 2 units below the pKa. That is the technical rule. Now, let me give you my easy answer. You ready for this? Run everything at pH 2. Run acids, bases, neutrals at pH 2. Now you're thinking, okay, that's way too simple. It is too simple, but it works. Let me explain why. pH 2 is the lowest pH that we're supposed to use in HPLC. You don't want to go below that, too much below it, because you do damage to the column. So if I go to the lowest pH, I will suppress every organic acid in the world that could be suppressed. So if your pKa is 5 or 4 is 6 or 4.5, I got you covered. pH 2 is golden. Now you could challenge me on that. You could say, hey, what if I have a pKa of 2? You got me there. I'd have to run a pH of 0, which I can't do. So my feeling is at pH 2, I will suppress any organic acid that could be suppressed. By the way, that's all of your carboxylic acids. We got them covered. So pH 2, all the acids are happy. All the neutrals, they don't care, so they're happy. Now let's talk about the bases. Historically, if we follow the same philosophy, we should run bases at pH 12. In theory, that is a good idea. In practice, please do not do that. You will destroy your column within hours. So at pH 12, you dissolve the silica. So we've always had this dilemma. How do we run bases? They're challenging. So here's my trick, and it sounds backwards. We run the bases at pH 2 as well. How does that work? I'll give you this. They're ionized. They are now positively charged. But the problem with the positive charge in the olden days was that our columns had a negative charge. We had silica left over, these silanols, and the two would stick together, and we get tailing peaks. But now we can buy columns without negative sites. We buy a good base-deactivated column. There are no negative sites, so the fact that this guy's positive is not so bad anymore. There's nothing to stick to. So pH of 2 is a great starting point for all acids, all bases, all neutrals. It works 90% of the time. Now, I'll put some of you in a special category. If you are a pharmaceutical company, personally, I just add acid to the mobile phase. I put phosphoric acid in my mobile phase, and it makes all tailing go away. It makes everything look beautiful. That's a pH 2. If you're a pharmaceutical company, you probably want to use a buffer. You probably want to be within a pH range. So the beauty of a buffer is if your source water is a little more acidic or a little more basic one day, if there's carbon dioxide in the air that dissolves and makes your mobile phase more acidic, the buffer will buffer that, will bring it back to its original pH. So the only reason I say it's important for pharmaceutical folks is because in your case, you have the FDA looking over your shoulder, and you really want to make sure that the mobile phase is the same today, tomorrow, and a year from tomorrow, that's where buffers come into play. So buffers, you're typically looking at phosphate buffers, sodium phosphate, phosphate buffers. Those are great. Acetate buffers, wonderful. An acetate buffer, and we also have formate buffers. So let me give you a little bit of how to choose. If you're running HPLC with UV detection, I love phosphate buffers. They are clean all the way to 190 nanometers. There's no absorption. Phosphate buffers are the way to go. If, however, you're doing LC-MS spec, if you have any plans to ever do LC-MS spec, you cannot use any non-volatile buffers. Phosphate buffers are out. So in that case, you want to use acetate or formate buffers. So if you're doing LC-MS spec, acetate formate buffer, it will also help the mass spec part because it helps in the ionization. If you're doing HPLC without mass spec, then I personally just use phosphoric acid. There's lots of choices out there. People use acetic acid, sulfuric acid, phosphoric acid, trifluoroacetic acid. Any of those are fine. I personally like phosphoric, nice and clean. I would never use hydrochloric acid. Don't use the halogenated acids because those are corrosive. So choosing a buffer, it sounds complicated, but my easy answer, pH 2, for most things in the world work great. And then if you have something special, then you're gonna have to do a little more research into the PKAs and so forth. So hopefully that helps. Hopefully that answered the question. And if you want more details on that, or if you need more help on that, give us a call, send us an email. That's what we're here for.